most of the expert insights to the panelists, I thought, from the perspective of Condé Nast traveler in India, that I'll share with you just some key insights that came out of a survey that Condé Nast Traveler did in May of 2020. There's just two points that I thought would be useful to highlight from what came out of that survey. And I should point out that the audience for us is very much based in the major metros of the country. The very first thing that came out loud and strong is that the urge and the desire to travel is alive and kicking. People have been speaking a lot about revenge spending in other parts of the world, but personally, I see a lot of revenge traveling taking place in India. Despite the very strict lockdown, Condé Nast Traveler has seen a 100% increase in digital audiences on our website. People are hungry for information on travel. They are consuming lots and lots of travel content every day. They're getting inspired, and they're understanding, trying to understand as much as they can about what is possible, what is safe, what they can and cannot do. They are constantly and continuously making plans to travel. So I think that's a fair bit of very positive news for all of us here and for all of you watching as well. The second point I'd like to make before handing over to the panelists is that where we are likely to travel, why and how we are likely to travel is all changing. And that presents new opportunities when the time comes. Our survey indicated that travelers are still keen to travel for leisure internationally and domestically in 2020 itself. Internationally, destinations like the Maldives, Bhutan, Sri Lanka, Australia, New Zealand, and Europe are seeing exceptionally high interest. But there is also an increased focus on sustainability. Travelers are recognizing the impact of their footprints on the environment. This also gives us the chance to showcase best practices in ecotourism and to demonstrate the very positive impact that responsible tourism can have on local communities. Condé Nast Traveler has therefore launched a series in India called How to Be a Better Traveler, which now has actually spread to other editions of Condé Nast as well in the UK and the US. We see a similar increase in wellness tourism as well and are now creating content specifically to address that. So we do see that new opportunities will arise. The question, of course, now is how do we get ourselves to that point? How can we best prepare ourselves, both in the short term as well as the long term? With that in mind, I would like to hand over to my first panelist to speak. Madam Meenakshi Sharma, please, would you start and take a few minutes to get all of your points across that you consider most important.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much, Dr. Suri, and all the panelists, all esteemed panelists here, and Divya for just bringing such a good introduction. Subject which we are discussing today is of extreme importance, and I think we are talking of the same thing almost after 15 days when we thought of the subject, at least at my level, and things have changed. So when we talk of the future of tourism today and how the Indian tourism industry is going to look at it, there are certain things which have happened during this time, which are showing the, I would say, in a positive light, but I would like to just put my thoughts into two, three parts. The first part is that when is the first question, when do we start? So that is one question which I think none of us are able to answer as of now. Ministry and the state governments and the industry all happen to think that domestic tourism would start the first. We hope so. So we are also putting all our thoughts in how do we encourage people to travel domestic tourism. There are certain challenges, and I think because as I'm representing Ministry of Tourism, I like to bring those challenges in front and see how we can handle them together. The way India is handling COVID is very well known, but there are differences between one state to another. The numbers are very differently rising in times from one week to the other. So even if there is no restriction on traveling domestically, and I also know, and we have some reports which say that short distance traveling has started, there are still some barriers. The barriers are both physical and also psychological. So that is the first challenge which we are looking at. So even if the physical barriers go, And when I talk of the physical barriers, I'm talking about the quarantine requirements, etc. That is something which we can obviously work on. However, the psychological barriers are going to be much stronger. This will bring me to the another question, which I will, I think, in very few seconds, I'll talk about is about the assurance. What kind of, like a small, off the back of the envelope has shown that people are actually preferring for domestic tourism resorts as compared to hotels. Now, how does that happen? It happens that the assurance level seems to be high. So what the industry is going to take care of those kind of psychological barriers, because it's not that we are going to work only for the resorts or the wellness thing. The tourism is a much wider subject. So I think the other question is, I think the confidence building seems to be the most important thing. The next point which comes that what is happening to the industry per se? How is industry is going to handle the pressure, economic pressure they have been under? And especially because we really do not know when we do go on the full scale, when do the business really start giving back the revenue? So what we can do, where and as we know how the whole financial situation is. So what more can be expected? What more can be done? So that is the next issue. Are there different ways of doing that things differently? Another thing which has happened interestingly is that a lot of new interest has been getting generated. When we went with our Dekho Apna Desh webinar, we never hoped that we will go beyond 20 series. You know, that was the limit we were looking at. Today we have crossed 40. The interest may have come down a little. Initially we were getting 4,000 viewers, etc. But we are getting much interesting subjects, still sufficiently good viewership, which also shows people are looking for a different kind of tourism. And all these webinars never have been a typically domestic, going to a place. And I think people are hungry for now good stories, a longer stay. So I think these are the things how the tourism is changing. And as far as Ministry of Tourism is looking at, we are working very closely with the various ministries, whether it is Home Affairs, whether it is External Affairs, Ministry of Health, so that whenever we are ready to open the international borders, because domestic tourism is our thing, but international tourism, what we are looking at the whenever the things become normal, this is something which we are going to be focusing upon. So then, so we are working very in with them that as and when the rigidities come down, the barriers come down, that we are ready to receive our guest in a better fashion, whether it's about e-visa, whether it's about assurance. Ministry of Tourism has also come out with a project along with the QCI, how to provide the assurance. So with QCI, a new project is coming up, which provides a self-assessment based and even at a letter inspection based assurance that this particular homestay or hotel or service provider is taking care of all the COVID related protocols. So I think this is something when it will provide an assurance to the prospective tourists that they can visit, they can go. And the next thing would be about how do we go to the world and say that India is ready to receive the tourist. So that would be the next stage. We are already working on the content, but the timing of coming out with that promotion has not been yet decided, because for very obvious reason, we are still where we are. So I think we have to take our time and do it because a message cannot go without the fact that it happened. When does it happen? So I think that would be my initial comments, and I can come in again if I'm required. Thank you.
Absolutely, ma'am. Thank you so much. I'm sure there'll be lots of questions for you going forward as well. Mr. Billa, would you like to go next for the few minutes?
Sure. Thank you, Divya. In her introductory remarks, Dr. Suri said that this is unprecedented. So I think a good place to start from is to figure out where we are and what the situation looks like. One way to look at it from a historical perspective is in 2003, we had the SARS epidemic, and then international tourist arrivals contracted by 0.4%. In 2009, we had the global economic crisis. And at that point of time, the tourist arrivals shrunk by 4%. But today, we are looking at a drop of anywhere between 58 to 78%. So that is, you know, clearly unprecedented. And what it means in numbers is one, that it will mean a reduction in international tourist arrivals of 1 billion the world over. In terms of tourism revenues, that's going to be a drop of $1 trillion. And in terms of job losses, we are looking at least 100 million job losses across the world. So I think clearly the situation is something that no business contingency plan would have factored in for, nor, you know, any government support can handhold the industry to get through this without any pain. So I think that is where we are. And I think India will also need to look at itself as a part of that, you know, that entire ecosystem that there is. And the IMF has revised its, you know, outlook for 2021. And they've said that there is going to be a contraction this year of 4.9%. And even the next year's bounce back is only about 3.7, 3.8%. And we must appreciate that it is happening on a smaller base that's going to be on this year. So I think 2021, any real recovery is going to happen in 2021. But that is not going to be, you know, such a strong recovery as well. So I think we need to understand that it's not something that will just go away like that. The second is for the tourism sector. We really do not have the luxury of waiting for the vaccine, because we're still waiting for human trials to get over. And as and when we have a definitive vaccine, what is the, you know, speed with which it can be deployed and people will start traveling again? That is still something that we need to look at. So I think we need to see as to how we can restart the tourism sector without waiting for a definitive medicine or a vaccine. And countries which have gone through the first wave of infections, like Spain and Italy, have gone ahead and opened up their countries for tourism. The key to really opening it up is, as Mrs. Meenakshi Sharma said, is assurance. Because it's not, you know, unless you have very strong health and hygiene safety protocols in place, it's going to be very difficult for people to travel, because nobody wants to expose themselves to risk when they travel. So it's not enough to just, you know, kill the virus, as it were. It's important to kill the anxiety amongst the travelers as well. And this will broadly depend upon two elements. The first is we need to do good gatekeeping. That is to ensure that people who are traveling into your country do not bring the virus and infect the host population. So I think we need to have, there are different ways of doing it, by asking them to come with COVID-free certificates or vaccinations or antibody certificates. That is gatekeeping. The second is at all touch points, starting from the airport to the time, you know, at hotels, at restaurants, even public washrooms at destinations, you know, viewing spots, all of those things we need to work diligently to ensure that, you know, the protocols are in place to reassure people that we're taking adequate care. The third point that I would like to make is that the international travel is going to take some time to, you know, kick off, because there are several health advisories which are out there. There are some countries which have gone through the infection, but they're also sort of not figured out whether they're out of the woods or they're still there. There are several countries to whom the infection is just spreading. So I think as a general case, it's going to be a while before international travel will pick up. And I think that's going to be anywhere between Q1 to Q2 of next year, when, you know, if and when the vaccine comes and everything goes according to plan, I think we will see robust demand picking up only Q1 and Q2 for international travel. If that is the case, I think for India, we have a big advantage of having a very strong domestic demand, not just people who are holidaying in the country. We receive 11 million tourists coming into the country, but we send out 24 million. So I think that's a very large number, and they spend close to $25 billion outside. So I think the challenge for the tourism industry and for the government really is to see as to how we can retain, you know, this purchasing power within the country. And that should help us tide over. That will soften the impact significantly. The fourth and the last point is that as an industry, I think it gives us an opportunity to hit the reset button. We all know that it's not going to be business as usual once the world reopens. We're going to be looking at a few things, like we're going to be factoring in for the environmental cost beyond economic cost. We're going to be looking at destinations and business establishments moving closer towards zero carbon footprint. We're going to be looking at zero food miles. We're going to be looking at community-centered experiences and meaningful experiences. So I think the nature of tourism is going to change. And I think the mass tourism, as we know, the low-cost, high-volume mass tourism, as we know, is probably going to take a hit. So I think it also gives us an opportunity to press the reset button and starting now, plan as to how we need to see that change happening for us to emerge much stronger. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Billa. That's a lot of ground that you've covered very quickly. Appreciate it. Mr. Banerjee, would you like to go next?
Okay, thank you. First of all, good afternoon to Jyotsnaji, you, all my panelists, and all the people who are listening in today. Thank you very much. Suman Billa has already covered the crisis that has hit the world over time. But what are the lessons that we have learned from those crises? When the 9/11 came, it was unprecedented, and nobody was prepared for it. And it was not a coordinated effort that went into controlling it. And it took 4 years for us to control the, come back to normal. The next crisis was the 2008 eco crisis. We recovered faster. We looked into it in a more coordinated way. The G20 platform was set up at that time, and the ministers of tourism and finance of all these countries got together, and that's why you were able to solve the crisis in about 16 to 18 months. Then was the SARS, Ebola crisis, which hit the world. And we again recovered from that much faster because the virus was isolated. Now this virus, the COVID-19 is, as we all know, it's nearly 80% asymptomatic. And, it's going to take a very long time to control it. So how are we dealing with it? What are the things that we need to think about in this sort of a situation? There are a couple of principles that I will talk about. The first is that, we should have a very coordinated approach between the private and the public sector. And we have to open up our borders. We have to think about what we need to do. What are the corridors that we can start? There are good examples in this. Australia, New Zealand are opening out the corridors, and many other countries in Asia also. But we need a very coordinated approach, not like the ones we are having. For example, I'll just give an example. In India, when we came out with these border restrictions, there were 27 states and 5 in union territories, all with different stipulations on border restrictions. Some will have 14-day quarantine, some will have 7-day institutional quarantine, some will have a 72-hour COVID test before you can move. Now, we need to think about it in a more rational manner, in a more standardized manner. And, I would say we should not have Daroga approach. We should have a Munna Bhai approach when we talk to tourists, Otherwise, it's creating a very sort of a negative effect there. The second thing that we need to do is that we have to standardize our protocols. And here I would like to say that WTTC, along with in consultation with CDC Atlanta and UNWTO and World Health Organization, they've come out with protocols on 6 sectors. And if you see those fine print of those protocols, it covers everything from airlines to airports. How should the things move? How should the normalization come about? Then tour operators, then conferences, and then retail. and these sort of protocols. And we should look at these protocols so that if we follow that, if we standardize that, then you know our travel experience can be uniform. And the other principle that we need to think about in a very coordinated manner is the support from government. We need this support. It should not be a switch on and switch off. It should be continuous. This is a time when we need to hold hands and think about how to bring back confidence. And it has to be a continuous support. And I'm sure Meenakshi just now mentioned that all the wonderful work that they are doing, but much more needs to be done. And one of the things that needs to be done very soon is to open out these hotels and open out the Airbnbs, open out the travel lodges. Let people travel. Get your norms in place, but let people travel. We must bring back demand. You know, you have started the airlines, you've started flying. People are flying now, but when they fly, where do they go? The hotels are still not open in many places. And that's something which we need to think about and bring back demand. So there, many countries have dealt with this in a very mature manner. And one of the examples that I can give is, when the H1N1 crisis that hit the world, the strategy that Mexico adopted. It was like a domestic strategy where they made a master plan and they made sectoral plans and they made regional plans. And then they brought in new areas of travel. They called it magical cities and travel routes. And it was a very coordinated manner in which they went, and we should learn from them. Only now, next, and then beyond. We have to think about three different types of things, not only now, but then next and beyond. And while we are doing all that, we should think about all the systemic inefficiency that are there in very various sectors and try to remove it. The WTTCII came out with a white paper recently on policy reforms in the hotel and hospitality sector. And it has given a set of recommendations which are not financial. It doesn't involve any financial implications. It needs tweaking of policy. It looks at FSIs, it looks at green norms, it looks at the setbacks and these type of things that it looks at. And we have sent it to government and let's see what comes of it. So we have to think about all these sectors and remove the systemic inefficiencies and think of next and beyond. Thank you.
Divya, you're on mute.
I'm here. Thank you very much for that. You've made a lot of great points, which I'm going to come back to just after we let Mr. Kalra say a few words. I know that much of what you wanted to say might have been slightly touched upon, but I know you have many, many other insights you can add to this. So please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you, Divya. Absolutely. I think in your opening remarks and then after you, Meenakshi ji, Suman ji, and Sujit ji have made really great points. And I can't disagree with any of them, but let me speak from an industry's point of view. There is no doubt that there is a pent-up demand for people wanting to travel. We are all hearing that. We are all seeing that. And I like the term revenge travel, and it will happen when it happens. I think the reality is that's only going to happen unbridled once we have a vaccine or a cure. Till that time, people are still going to be very cautious, very wary, even afraid to travel. So let's focus at that time. Let's focus about the time now, which is how can we go about unlocking travel? We're going about different phases of unlock for the country as we have to, because the economic impact has been pretty severe. And as we go about that and cities open up and workplaces open up, even malls open up and restaurants open up, I think the travel unlocking needs more care, needs to be thought through. I really like the point that Mr. Banerjee made about having a common protocol across each and every state to start with. See, we can't impact what other countries are doing so easily. Of course, through our good offices of the MOT, the kind of work that Sumanji is trying to do, we will find travel partners or travel bubbles which will have common protocols. But only we can have the same protocol in the country first. So I think this has got to go beyond political affiliations of the state. We have to have a common and a logical protocol across. You can't have flights operating. Incidentally, the number of flights percentage of departures is up to about 25-26%. But load carried is only 15-16%. So that means flights are going fairly empty, only at about occupancy levels, which can definitely be improved. And that's happening, if you drill down, largely because of the quarantine requirements, which are different in different states. So people are again vary. So the proposal I want to put forward to everyone here is that we need to use testing before travel or the carrying of a negative certificate as a passport to travel, which should then do away with the need to get quarantined, at least in the country. Today, testing has been opened up. Getting a PCR, RT-PCR test, which is the most authoritative test, is no longer that difficult. There's ample amount of testing. The prices have come down. They are at about 2,400 rupees. Perhaps in bulk, they'll come down even further. But once you have an RT-PCR certificate, 48 or 24 hours before you travel, you should not need to be quarantined. In fact, that could be made a passport to travel. Alternatively, what could happen is that when you show up at a destination, you can be tested if you have not got that done. I am more in favor of it becoming a passport to travel, even if you say the test to be used is an antigen test, which has its own limitations, but is cheaper and faster. 30-minute result, rapid testing can be done even at airports and other places, points of departure. Or you look at the NAT test. Any of these tests which can be used and accepted, and obviously ICMR will have to bless them, will give so much confidence to the other travelers. So today we have 15% people traveling. It's not because of the price being high. It's because of the fear. What about the balance 85%? Most of them are not getting onto that plane or not taking that trip because they're afraid that other people will be carrying the infection and they could pick it up at the airport or in the plane or in even if it's road transport. That's why people are very happy to drive out by car. That will happen. And we are all saying that's happening. But even the complications there of the requirements of different states are deterring people. Otherwise, there's so many people wanting to get into their cars and drive up to a cooler climb right now from parts of the country that are hot or even to other places, even like Goa. We know in the monsoons is so lovely, but people are all worried about what is the norm. I think Goa took a very good step at saying we will test everyone who will arrive. But a classic case, I think, of what happened was one step forward and two steps back. And therefore, more than arrival, we should be carrying this certificate before we depart. Because when you arrive, then people are told, okay, we are doing a PCR test for you. 24 hours, please self-isolate yourself in a hotel room. Now, that is wishful thinking. Because firstly, you're going to go about carrying a potential infection right through the airport, to the taxi, to the hotel staff. And then you may or may not isolate yourself anyway. So I think the right way to do it is on the pre-boarding. And I would request everyone to think about that seriously. We need a common protocol. We have Meenakshi ji here. Ma'am, your voice is very important here. If you think this is logical, then we can start putting this forward as an industry. I'm also speaking to the Ministry of Civil Aviation, to the secretary there. And I think we should have a common understanding among ourselves. Only then will travel get unlocked. If we can do it in the country, I can assure you it will follow even internationally, which is beyond our control immediately. But logical countries, we have places like Germany testing everyone on arrival. Japan is testing. If we start giving a certificate from an authorized lab and saying that, listen, this certificate should be accepted, I think there's a good chance with the travel bubbles that we will get the other countries also to say, especially places like UAE who need our traffic, Singapore, maybe definitely Thailand and other places to say, yes, we will accept this. You don't need to get quarantined now. So that's my main submission and I want to keep it to that. The rest of the points have been largely covered. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Deep. Ma'am, of course, I think the overwhelming talk here, of course, is about making sure that from a domestic tourism standpoint, that there is a uniformity and a clarity of rules and regulations and commonality across the country. But can I ask you, is this realistic? How far away are we from coming to a situation like that where all of the states can be made to follow a common protocol? Is this something that we can expect to happen? What is it like at the current moment? I'm sure there's many challenges, but if you could give us that insight, I think that's topmost in everybody's mind.
Completely, I think it's absolutely required. I mean, I'm completely agree with Mr. Deep Kalra that it is absolutely required, and Ministry of Tourism as an entity would be the real advocate for it and want to be the advocate. However, about the timing, about the putting it on the paper, making the state government to agree to it is something we should start working on. Because I think we start the process now, because as of now, I don't know about the numbers. I do not know when are we going to peak and when do we start climbing down. But these things take time. So even if we start it now, maybe in a 2 weeks, 3 weeks time, we can have some consensus. Because ICMR and Ministry of Health might come out with such a suggestion on the request of Ministry of Tourism and the industry. But making the state governments do that also requires a little more persuasion and also some reality check, the reality check on the ground. However, I completely in agreement that we should work towards this objective. So from the Ministry of Tourism, I can say, yes, we will work with you, with the industry to make this request and work on that. I'm sure there will be no difficulty on the principle of it. There may be some difficulty in implementing it, some of the state, depending on where we are as the COVID. Yes.
Well, the intention would be great to start with, of course. It all starts from there. Mr. Banerjee, you made a great point about how what is going to be key is obviously coordination between the states. But you've also made a great point about the need for more public and private partnerships. And that's something, of course, that will be now more important, I think, than ever before. Deep, you had, of course, worked very, very involved in the creation of the Arogya Setu app, which is, I think, a great example of a public-private partnership. Could you give us a little bit of insight into how that actually worked? And also, if you could tell us, what do you think would be the next round of public-private partnerships that would be key to this recovery?
Sure, Divya. And it's a pleasure to talk about it. I'll be very brief because I think lots to be clear. I think we got a unique opportunity and by none other actually initially than I think necessary sponsorship to go ahead and do it. So it was built in rapid time, actually, literally 3 weeks, but 30 people on it. And then we kept maintaining and developing it till just about recently, early July. We handed it to NIC, with the government right through all the suggestions. We had a committee which was represented by Niti Aayog, as well as the PMO directly. So a lot of also volunteers we got from academia. So professors from IIT, Chennai, other places, private sector volunteers. I think everyone came together. It was a unique example. We scaled it in about 140 million downloads. It was the fastest growing app in the world till 50 million downloads, all done in 13 days. Quite an experience. And I think everyone, it should be a case study. And if you can find, I think the magic is to find the kind of company who's genuinely excited about doing this. Why would they be excited? You can understand their motivations and then giving them a lot of latitude, which is exactly what we got because this was a tech project. So I think we have to look at strengths. I think innovativeness and entrepreneurship is probably better done in private sector. Not that there aren't great examples in the public sector. But the right model could be to take it to a certain point within the ages and within the government and then hand it over and then move to another. In travel too, I think we have great examples been done, but probably going forward and responsible to, I think we can play a big role in ecotourism. We can play a big role for infrastructure. We always need the government. But then, after that, allowing private sector to flourish, not a sense. And maybe what's been trying to be done in the Andamans is a good example of a very bold project. And I hope it will see light of day because I think we will need that kind of private sector participation there. But any project around technology, we will be very happy to put our hands up. Ma'am is here. We worked before together with them also. And very happy to, if you find anything worth our while, we'll be happy to.
Thanks very much, Deep. Since you've touched upon responsible tourism, and that's something that, again, I think we are at a certain point in time where it's a make or break situation. It's a great time to actually launch this in a very important way. I know, Mr. Banerjee, that you had some thoughts on responsible tourism and sustainable tourism. Would you mind elaborating a little bit on this and tell us what could be the opportunities that we have in India? And Mr. Billa, I would love for you to, I know that this is close to you as well. I would love to have both of your inputs on it.
Divya, this is absolutely the correct and the best time to sort of think about responsible tourism. And in fact, as you may be knowing, the Ecotourism Society of India changed its name to Responsible Tourism Society of India. And it was only because of this particular point that we all need to think about carrying capacity of every sector of our economy, whether it is the mountains, whether it is our national parks, whether it is our beaches, everywhere. And also, what are the things that we need to do? What are the responsibilities that we need to carry along with us, along with our equipment when we go to these places? And what are the things that we don't need to, you know, drop and throw here and there? This is absolutely the correct time to have a sustainable and responsible tourism. And that's one of the points that I wanted to make.
Mr. Billa, would you like to add to this?
So I think, you know, tourism is jobs, livelihoods, everything. But I think the important thing is, how do we maximize that benefit to the communities? And, you know, not all tourism benefits communities. So one of the opportunities that it is giving us now, and from what we see, our consumer preferences are going to change significantly post-COVID, because we've all discussed about how people, fear will be a factor in people taking decisions. But there will also be an ethical element to how people will take decisions. I think if nothing, the pandemic has actually chastised mankind significantly. And I think people are going to be looking at more meaningful experiences. They're going to be looking at more, being more responsible, more sustainable. So I think when this comes into play, and if consumer preferences are going to follow that line, the governments will come out with policies which support that. And I think this is a great opportunity for India, because we have a strong, robust tourism sector, but we can't say that all parts of it are, you know, work well for the community. So I think this gives us a good opportunity to press the reset button, to show our commitment to the environment, to show our commitment to the social values, and also to make sure that the communities are benefited, not just by way of job creation, but also by way of supplies and, you know, being a part of that ecosystem. So I think this is an, like they say, you shouldn't let a good crisis go waste. I think we should absolutely use this opportunity to reset that.
Ma'am Meenakshi, if I could ask you, is this going to be a key part of the government's agenda going forward when it comes to tourism? Is there anything specific that you are considering at the moment when it comes to responsible tourism and sustainability?
Yeah, obviously, because, I mean, as we all always been saying, that our emphasis should be on the responsible of sustainable tourism, but there are various parts to it. There are the parts, whether the policy support this, that kind of initiative, whether the state government, when we talk about the infrastructure project, take care of it, and whether industry follows it, and the end of the day, whether the tourist is also responsible. So as Suman has already mentioned, that this is the time to have a reset button. Let's absolutely rethink that how it can be done in whatever manner. One thing is that I think we are already in the process of making some changes to the new tourism policy, making the responsible tourism the foundation of it, because it is not a independent thing. It should be part of everything and all things which we do in part of the tourism. And the com- mean, there are various parts to the responsible tourism. We talk a lot about the environment. We do talk about how to involve the community development, but there are going to be some new, more elements which get added today. One is about health and hygiene now. It's also about the practices which people will do with each other. It is also the behavior of the tourist, that how it is a responsible tourism. It cannot be only the responsibility of the service provider. It has to be responsibility of service provider and the service taker. So I think this is something which we should be working on. And I think I can be honest about it, that we have not focused our attention as much as we should, even if we feel it very strongly. So I think, it will be our priority and we'll be working on it. Yes.
I think you have a panel full of people who would be more than happy to do some thinking for you in this regard, ma'am. So I think it's a wonderful bunch of people who feel very strongly about it, who'd be happy to help with that. Mr. Deva, I would like to ask you a question as well. There is a certain, people have mentioned that everything we've known about travel, everything that we've learned over the years, everything's going to change and we have to throw out everything that we have learned over the years and start afresh. Do you believe that that's true? Are we at a sort of watershed moment for travel, or do you think that the pandemic has simply accelerated trends that were already taking place? How do you feel about that?
Thank you, Divya. I'm happy to answer that question, although I was here only as an observer of Fiki. But now that you've given me the opportunity, let me say this. I don't think everything is going to change. It has definitely accelerated things. What is going to be different is when we come back, organizations will look very different. The entire delivery mechanism may be very different. We will be far more dependent on technology, and the way we work would be very different. We would have people probably working from their, you know, small little hometowns where there's an internet connection, or like where Mr. Banerjee is probably in the mountains where you can do your work. So the quality of life of people may actually improve depending on what kind of work do they have. Do they always have to be in the office or not? So organizations are going to look very different. And I think what the products that are going to be offered are in the beginning are going to be, as I call them, cautious products. So for example, a busload of people used to be 40 people coming in one busload. That is going to now go down to 20, 25 people. And that probably will stay, and which is probably not bad, because, you know, 40 in a bus is not really a great idea. Similarly, when Indians travel overseas, probably the same change is going to happen too. So it's going to only, that's good news as far as we are concerned. So yeah, to answer your question, certain things have been accelerated, technology will come into play. I things can only get better. Yeah.
Does this mean that travel is simply going to get more expensive for everybody? I'm happy for anyone to take that.
Yeah, let me answer that in a very simple way. Organizations that made profit over the year or ran their business with a sensible profit margin are today still standing and are able to manage their their running cost every month, because as you know, we don't have any revenue coming in. So I think that is a great learning for everybody, not to just throw away product and price and service. Everything comes at a price, and there must be profit made, a reasonable amount, and also the quality of services will have to definitely be looked at. The entire ecosystem will definitely improve.
Thank you for that. Sorry to put you on the spot that way. Mr. Kalwa, let me ask you, we have obviously the audience here is travel industry specific mostly. If you had one piece of advice to give to the industry today who is sort of hoping for good news or in some level, but really I think what they want to know is at this point in time when they are probably hurting, what is the single most important thing that you would tell them to invest their time, their energy, their money at this point in time?
Oh, that's a really good question. I'll tell you what we are following. Our logic is because we are a technology company in travel, we're trying to focus our energies on building new products, which will be useful, new products, services, and features when travel opens up in a bigger way. Trying to build features which can help people today, like a place where you can actually find out where you can travel, what you can do, almost like a COVID travel search engine. And actually, the most important one, which applies to non-travel, non-tech companies or any company, is to keep the team motivated. I think the team connect is the most important right now. It's a very tough time. Obviously, even the largest companies have had to let go of folks. And I'm sure it's the toughest decision anyone has to take at the top. But people who are there, I think your connect is very important, especially leaders. People are confused, they're lost, they're disappointed, they're dismayed, they're not sure when travel will pick up. There are things which we should be optimistic about. There are, you know, just green shoots right now, which we've spoken about, but we should build on them further. And I think that's important. So that would be definitely my advice.
Thank you. I did promise to ask a lot of hard questions on this panel, so I'm going to continue to do that. Mr. Billa, can you give us a sense? You're in Madrid at the moment, and you have a great perspective on what things are looking like from a global perspective. Could you give me a sense of how is it that people are viewing India at this time? How do you think India is faring? What is the sort of perception internationally of how we're going to bounce back and when? And could you give us some insight on that?
So I think broadly from a global perspective, the tourism sector is suffering, you know, has taken a hit everywhere. But one of the things that we clearly see is that the first part of the support, which the governments have extended to the industry, which several of them have called the, the revival package, or as it were, is not really a revival package. What they have sought to do is try to put money in the pockets of people who have lost jobs and whose businesses were stressed. So I think that is first phase. And I think that has happened at a time when we were wildly optimistic. We thought that by quarter two of this year, we will get past COVID and it will be a bad experience behind us. But it is lasting out much longer than we think. So I think as people started realizing it, especially the second wave of countries, they have started storing the money, preparing a war chest for health reasons, because you don't know what the vaccination cost will be. You don't know how much, or you'll have to augment your medical facilities, etc. But one of the things that we see is those who seem to have got a sense of overcoming the pandemic, they are actually moving towards revival packages. What are the strategic investments that we need to make? What is the, how do we take an entrepreneurial position as countries to ensure that, you know, the demand picks off and we sort of get the money into the coffers right away? For India, you know, tourism, inbound tourism is not, you know, so critical. It's big, you know, about 27, 28, but it's not really, you know, such a big number. But there are several countries where, especially the small island developing countries, where 70 to 75% of their GDP comes from tourism revenue. So for countries like that, so they need to take a position. So I think for Indians again, and especially for the Indian industry, I think we need to look for that second phase. We are now peaking in terms of the infection. And I think if Delhi and Bombay are beyond it, it will not be too long before the rest of the country goes. So irrespective of whether we have a vaccine by the end of the year or not, I think India would have reasonably, brought down that curve of epidemic, you know, towards the end of this year. I think by about October, November, we should be okay. So I think that is when the government will also start looking at making strategic moves on how to, really kickstart the economy. And I think the industry needs to have a game plan in hand. And it should never be of the nature that what you want, you go on like a crybaby, say that these are the 10 things that I want, is not going to work. You first need to look at what is it that the government can afford to give you, you know, because the governments are as broke as the industry is now. So you need to figure out what are the policy fixes that we can get in place. What is the, you know, critical support that we want, prioritize and go there. I think that exercise is something that we need to do. India is, there is good news and bad news. You know, India has some very strong, committed people who travel to India again and again. The draw of India is very strong. But at a general level, the perception about our safety and, you know, hygiene are not too strong. So especially after COVID, I think we need to double down and, you know, send that message much stronger. And this is not something that we can crack by taking it all across the country. I think select destinations where we want to take in travelers or where international travelers need to go, I think we need to do whatever it takes to make the travelers be reassured that they'll not be at risk when they travel to India.
Yeah, thank you for speaking so frankly, Mr. Billa. I appreciate that. And I think going back to what Meenakshi ji had also mentioned, it is very much a question of timing and doing the right thing, but also doing it at the correct timing. So I think you touched upon that as well, which is obviously very important. I'm going to move to the audience questions in just a bit. I just had one last one that I would like for Mr. Banerjee to answer. What would you say in India right now is the single greatest threat to travel and tourism today? And where do you think our greatest opportunity lies?
I'm very clear on that point. The threat is the COVID-19, but the opportunities are opening up the economy once again, getting people to go back to their normal. Look, on one side, you can have what the testings to be done on time. You need the contact tracing also to be done on time. You need the protocols to be followed to the nth degree. You can have travel insurance to assure the travelers. You can have tax benefits with something with deep Kalra had mentioned to be given to every citizen of this country to travel to a domestic destination. Have all that in place, but do open up. People have been locked up for too long. People want to get out. I can give you a small example. I am in the hills, and I know that some travelers, they came to the hills and they were stopped at the check post. So what they did was they told their car to go back. They walked over the mountains, avoided all the barriers, and reached Almora to stay in a beautiful resort. And who cares? And they said, "Ki, we don't. This is heaven for us." So let people do their business once again. Thank you.
Thank you for that. That's very tempting. An example that you've shared. Before I go to the questions, ma'am, I think, would you like to say anything else? Obviously, there is a tremendous amount that the industry is hoping for from the government. And I know, of course, that while you all are working extremely hard, like you said, it's a question of timing. But is there anything that you'd like to say to this community of people watching from the industry? What would you like for them to take away from this?
Yeah. I think all the suggestions which have been made are really kind of touch upon what we need to do immediately and in a very, very logical fashion. So as far as the opening of the economy and the opening up of the travel is concerned, I think as far as Government of India is concerned, it is kind of, there is no bar to it. However, state governments have their own limitations. And again, I would say that we are really ready to coordinate with the state government. We are doing that. And we'll keep doing it. So that is one. Other thing is, I just wanted to say, when Mr. Kalra mentioned something, is that, you know, the only single issue which is making all the people who are sitting at their home and working, and everybody's a little depressed. I don't know what you see, but I see 80% of the people have some kind of a little, you know, restlessness, depression, even if we are, like, I think, for good or bad, I'm not in that category because we did not even get a one day of lockdown. So, which is the other way to get depressed, okay? We didn't get to sit at home at all. But I know, so the, you know what they're missing the maximum is that they are not able to go out. So the kind of the, you know, this pent up feeling that we need to go out, but we need to go out safely. That is the something which is making all our thought process in Ministry of Tourism to think about it. People want to go out, people want to go out where they are not harassed, because it's not about only being safe. It is also the, if there should be no harassment, like that you reach somewhere, but you can't come back. So I think these are the very crucial issues. As far as the incentives are concerned, we in Ministry of Tourism are very keen to provide some kind of incentive to the domestic traveler. We are already have been, you know, having in discussion at the various, you know, the Ministry of Finance and other authorities. And I hope it comes, you know, because I think this is something which will help. I think it's, again, it's not so much of the monetary value. It is about creating kind of environment that this is the what thing is a desirable. And I think that's what, and again, the responsible tourism, being responsible both from the health and environment and community and by the travelers themselves, because our fellow travelers should also take care that we do not create something which is not desirable. So I think these are the four things I would like to say, which I think surprisingly, I see that national government, international organization, industry, and the association all are on the same page because we are looking for the same problems and the same solutions.
I think the key is very much going to be working together and putting everyone's heads together to really bring out, really use this crisis, as Mr. Villa said, use this crisis to its best potential so we can all come out of it. I'm just going to take a couple of questions from the audience now. We have quite a few of them. So I'll just focus on a couple because we don't have much time. The first one is for Mr. Kalra. Do you think the pandemic has leveled the playing field? Can small players collaborate with bigger players now?
Yeah, I think it's a great question, firstly. I think I like what Sumanji said in terms of every crisis actually being an opportunity. And I think this is an opportunity for innovative companies, for companies that are flexible, are willing to tweak their business and even try new things. So I definitely think if people are able to change what they're doing because of the need, and you know, we look around, how have so many people sprung up suddenly? And all of us know people who are either manufacturing PPE. Now, many of them were exporters. We all know them. And you know, why not? Because there was an opportunity there. But we also know people who had nothing to do with the office maintenance or cleaning business. But I get a proposal a day with someone having the latest technology in how to make offices virus-free, et cetera, as people go back to work. Now, some of them are obviously doing it well. Similarly, in travel, we'll have to be innovative. And one example, maybe Deepak touched upon it, I think is homestays is a logical place where people would like to be. But are there enough maintenance services for homestays? Only in some parts, not everywhere. Now, that is something a local entrepreneur can do very easily and very well. In fact, they're the best suited to do it. You can't expect someone headquartered in Delhi, Bombay, or Bangalore to go care of homestays in Uttarakhand or in Goa or in Coorg. It'll be someone local. So I think if companies are willing to do that, there's going to be big opportunities. This is just one of them. But around this whole space of safe travel, responsible travel, and definitely we would be very happy to collaborate with such companies.
That's a great great business idea you've given lots of people, Deep. Thank you for that. Ma'am, there's one question for you as well. How can the government and the industry work together to sensitize and influence the travelers to bring back confidence when it comes to travel?
I think as far as the industry and government in tourism, they have always been working together and have to work together. Government has come out with certain protocols, but how the protocols are followed and how the protocols are kind of seen being followed is something which the industry can do and which can bring the, because there are the different level of assurances which a prospective tourist would look at. So I think that is something which we have to work. We have also to promote certain destination which would in the short term, which are going to meet the needs of the traveler today. So I think that is something again which the tourist service providers will look at and then say, these are the only thing which we would propose you. Whether it can be different for different area, whether in adventure or in a hill, there are going to be. And government obviously cannot discriminate so much. It's the industry which can come out with a specific product and the thing we can. I think there is a, on each thing we can collaborate today, because I think the crisis is so much for everything. We are the crisis together and we'll be in solution together.
That's very nicely put, ma'am. Thank you so much for that. We have a minute of time left, so I'm afraid I'm going to have to close up. But I know Mr. Deva would like to do a quick roundup of the takeaways from this. So thank you very much for answering all of these questions, and I'll hand over to you, Deepak.
Thank you so much. I mean, this has been one of, you know, there have been a lot of webinars that have run from the 24th of March, but today has been one of those very refreshing ones because there's a lot of good thought and good ideas. I'm not going to repeat it because a lot has been said. But, you know, from an international overseas client point of view, you know, Deep has really driven the domestic agenda very well, right from the ideas in the starting, of course, with the app. And also now about talking about bubbles, I think, you know, Deep, there could also be an opportunity where two states could create a bubble amongst themselves. I think right now the problem is that it's too wide the scope. So everybody is all over the place. And this morning when we were talking to the two secretaries from Odisha and Chhattisgarh, neighboring each other, it could be a great model of two or three states coming together and trying to find opportunities and then building confidence and then expanding it further. I think right now, when you talk of an opportunity to travel domestic, everything just comes to a grinding halt because you say, oh, I'm in Calcutta and I can't go to Bangalore or something like that. So that could be something which could be looked at through the government. And your idea of, I think, the certificate cuts across kinds of travel. If that becomes the passport, whether it is domestic or international, and if we accept it, I think Suman brought that point very clearly also saying, open up, you need to open up it as and when the consumer will decide. You know, that's another thing we have to also remember. Whilst we may come up with various ideas of opening up, at the end of the day, the consumer has to really bite the product and say, okay, I'm getting on that plane and going to India. Now, there is just one recommendation that I would have, Divya, if you allow me. The Ministry of Tourism has to eventually focus on overseas marketing for the incoming tourists into India, like each state will do for their domestic tourists. However, I would strongly recommend at this stage that the Ministry of Tourism and the Ministry of External Affairs come together and implement a plan for promoting India again, because embassies can play a very major role in the recovery of our business. My last point, I'm very happy everybody spoke about sustainability, and I know it's Divya, this is a subject very close to you. I know Suman is so involved, so is Deep, so is the ministry, and Mr. Sharma was very honest to say that they need to do more, which is there. Mr. Banerjee obviously is involved with us at the Responsible Tourism Society. I am not sure, I was strange feeling sustainability might take a back seat when commerce has to come back and there is this whole survival and revival race going on. I think we need to sensitize and educate the industry more in the next few months. And I would propose that along with Suman and along with you, with Fiki and our Responsible Tourism, we do another seminar with the government and invite Deep and Mr. Banerjee to contribute to that, so that we actually bring some sort of, you know, idea to the industry. Everybody talks about it, but, you know, what is the action plan? So we need a robust action plan on that, if I may say so. So with that, Divya, thank you very much for inviting me to speak.
Thank you so much. I think you're absolutely right, Deepak. That's a great point that you made regarding sustainability. But, you know, one of the big things that we also must emphasize in tourism is to start measuring not just footfalls, but to also measure revenue. And sometimes you make a lot more revenue with much fewer people coming in, which is much more sustainable and responsible as well. And that would be, I think, definitely a good point as well to take forward. But with that, thank you very much for having me. Dr. Suri, thank you again. And thank you to all of the panelists, Meenakshi ma'am, Suman, Deep, and Sujit sir, as well as Deepak. Thank you all very much for being here and for kicking this conclave off. I think it was a great session, and I look forward to the rest. So thank you all very much for your time.
Thank you. Thank you for being the host today. Thank you on behalf of FICCI.
Thank you very much. Thank you.